Financial Survival Network, helping you survive and thrive in the new economy. Go to carrielutz.com and sign up for 30 free micro trainings on financial survival.
WGCH. This is Kerry Lutz. You're listening to the Financial Survival Network. If you're wondering what the high net worth people are doing in this market, my next guest, Danielle Park, is a reformed attorney like myself, money manager. She's got a website, Juggling Dynamite, which I've done a few times myself. Not advised. Danielle, how you doing?
Hi, how are you, Kerry?
Good, and thanks for being on the Financial Survival Network. We're in interesting times now, aren't we?
Absolutely. I think survival is an excellent starting point in terms of everything people are thinking and doing today.
Yeah, because we're more concerned about return of capital than return on capital, right?
Yes, but also I think we're getting into some pretty exciting opportunities coming down the pipe as well. We're very defensive at the moment, but I'm interested to see what cyclical opportunities present in the coming year. I think we're getting into another potentially the next phase, shall we say, of this particular financial crisis. And just like in 2008-09, it brought great opportunity for those who knew what to look for, and I think we might see that again. So I am cautious for sure, but I'm also looking for opportunities over the next little while.
Right. I mean, when we really hit the bottom in 2008, 2009, that was, in retrospect, a golden opportunity where savvy investors really cashed in because so many stocks were driven down for a number of reasons that had absolutely nothing to do with the viability of the enterprises involved. And you think we're going to hit something like that again, huh?
Yeah. Well, you know, the interesting thing is, from my perspective, as a risk manager, we see financial markets as a secondary option at all times. So really the underlying viability, the balance sheet and income statement of companies, the pure financial fundamentalness of companies is only a factor. It is certainly not the driving factor, in my view, for these price swings. So when people say, you know, I don't understand why good companies sell off with bad companies, the point of it is that in the kind of dynamic we're working with in capital markets, where money flow is truly global, where you have a highly levered system, where margin players and people on, 30, 40 to 1 institutions are trading in these asset classes, really you have to be very aware of that auction process. So when you say, for example, that, you know, everything was sold off and some of it was perhaps not justified, I look at the broader trends from a macro perspective. You know, everything was overbought to an extreme that we have never seen in human history in the late 90s. So starting from that valuation level, we entered into this secular bear market, this downturn cycle that goes on and fits and starts for roughly 15 to 20 years. And so each time you get into a overshoot of realistic economic expectations, you're going to get this next phase of disappointment. And so our point would be that people have to just accept the world that they're in. Like, we are in winter. This is the analogy I like to give people. We are in winter. When you're in winter in Canada, where I live, you better know how to cope with winter. You better get some good boots. You better put on your snow tires. You better drive with caution on icy roads, or you're going to just keep getting hurt and thrown offside and in the ditch. However, if you're well equipped, if you know what to expect in winter, you can actually prepare yourself, navigate yourself well through it, and not be hurt. It's just the people that are following the old dogmas of the secular bull phase, or who are doing things like trying to buy things on fundamental valuation concepts and not worrying about selling because they like the company. No more fatal words were ever spoken, right? So when you're protecting capital, everything has to be with that as the primary focus and with the overall climate in mind.
Right. So, break out the all-wheel drive vehicle with the steel-studded snow tires and bring a set of chains if you have them and prepare. And I think the problem that people have, a lot of investors, myself included, in the past, is not knowing that you're going, that you were in summer and, you know, all the trees had leaves on them. Now we're heading to fall. The leaves are starting to fall off, and then we hit winter. And people don't get that until they see like a multi-thousand point drop in the indexes. So how do you, I mean, my theory is always, hey, in times of peace, prepare for war. In times of war, prepare for peace. But how do you really prepare is the question.
Well, yeah, it's a mindset. First of all, I think that people have been brainwashed, or maybe that's a too strong a word, but educated in a very linear thinking fashion, which has not served well, because we have been in this condition of worsening economic climate, of headwinds that are going to go on for probably another 5 to 7 years as we work to the end of this secular period. And so all of the people who are, you know, who were only trained in summer, who only expect good conditions at all times, continue to give people very harmful advice. And the financial industry is just full of it. Not a lot of thinking going on there. Not a lot of appreciation of history. I was watching an interview the other day about, I think it was on Charlie Rose, but they were talking about how the Western school system really has failed us in many ways, because people have done things like an undergraduate in business, gone on to an MBA degree, or, you know, some specialization, and have not done any lateral broad study of humanity, of behavior, of history, and that's been an enormous deficit. And that's part of why we got into the conditions we are today, because people didn't appreciate that from 1982 to 1999, they had the best possible economic environment climate that you could ever have, you know, and that was brought on by the period of fiscal austerity and discipline that preceded it for about 15 to 20 years during the prior secular bear period, when, you know, again, people came into 82 with stocks at the lowest valuations in decades, with dividend yields above 8%, with the savings rate above 15%, you know, all this built up strength in the economy, in the consumer's balance sheet, et cetera, discipline in their behavior and their spending habits, because they'd already learned that interest rates go up and that's bad for you if you're levered. So they come into the early 80s with all that in their favor, and then tax rates start to be cut. That helps. Inflation starts to fall. Interest rates start to fall. All those conditions. And if you weren't aware historically that was a really incredible opportunity and period, you would expect that to continue. But if you'd done any sort of research and study, you would realize it never continues. It's always a finite period. If you get 15 to 20 years like that, you're lucky. And then you should expect the opposite again. So it's that, you know, mental flexibility or ability to understand the changing nature of it that's key to survival, I think.
Yeah, and that's so interesting, because you go back to the 20s, the roaring 20s, and that was similar to the 80s and 90s at this time. And we were in a new economy. You didn't need, you know, it didn't matter. You could just buy real estate. You could buy stocks, and they were going to go up and make you rich. And then all of a sudden, for whatever reasons, the rug got pulled out from them in 29. And then we had a depression that continued from 29, arguably through World War II. One of the big mistakes in history is crediting FDR with bringing the country, the U.S., and the world out of the depression, when nothing could have been further from the truth. And then, you know, after World War II, the economy expanded, happened for a long time, till the 70s, till the oil shocks. And yeah, we don't teach history anymore in the schools, I guess, is what I'm saying. And you can go back in ancient history, follow all of these booms and busts. It's built into the human DNA. And this time is not different. This time only feels different. And until people get that, they're really condemned to keep repeating the mistakes they made in the past, right?
Yeah, except they learn. Except they've always learned before. Eventually, people do learn and change behavior. But the problem is that each generation's memory is as long as its own experience. So You know, my grandparents were very wise, but they lived through the Depression. I was lucky I grew up next door to them. They taught me stuff that helps me today. My parents came in, they were baby boomers. You know, they came in early boomers right at the start. Very advantageous conditions, helped by the frugality and discipline of their parents to get a start with not much debt, all that. So they really came into it with the wind at their back, didn't develop a lot of good habits, didn't teach their children very good habits. And so, you know, our generation, I think, is learning it the hard way, but that seems to be the only way we humans do learn it, is the hard way. And, you know, obviously governments can't fix what's wrong today, because it's a over-indebtedness that has to be worked out over time. But at the same time, you know, where I think proactive steps can be taken, and again, they always are. Part of the reason we set up for this great secular run from 82 was some of the intelligent policies that were brought in after the horse had left the barn in the last crash, of course. But, you know, things like Glass-Steagall, keeping the salesmanship out of the banking side, that's basic. And they chipped away at that over time, and now we're paying the price. Because humans can't give unbiased advice if they're being paid to sell risk. That's just the way it is. If you're being paid to sell loans in the real estate business, if you're getting commissions for the bigger the loan, you're going to sell bigger and bigger loans. It's just the way it works, right? So we do, the only thing I think regulation can do, and I know a lot of people are very anti-regulation, they think only free market forces are the answer. I disagree with that, because that's like saying human beings can govern themselves at all times. We know they can't, obviously. Some of us do it better than others. Some of us can't do it at all. But when there's financial incentives directing behavior in certain patterns, which we know are self-destructive from thousands of years of human history, why would we not try and curtail, you know, certain incentives and inspire people to make, you know, like it used to be that you'd go to your banker in the old days and you'd say, could I have a loan? And he'd say, well, Harvey, you know, and he'd talk to you about what your financial scenario was and would be looking out for you, because he didn't want you to get too much debt. Why? Because it would be his problem if you had too much debt, right? That's what we need in a banking system. You need to have an older subset that's aware of stuff, that can advise younger people. Instead, what we got was the opposite in the last 20 years, where anyone that wanted a loan would be given it, no questions asked. No one ever said to them, do you think you really should borrow more money, Harvey? Like, don't you think you got enough debt? No one had those conversations, and now we're paying the price for that. So,
yeah, great point you make, which is a kind of lack of responsibility and accountability that's baked into the system. I mean, if you take a kid in their teens and you say, look, I'm going to pay you $10 for every cigarette you smoke until you're addicted, they're going to do it, right? Yeah. They're going to become nicotine addicts. And that's the thing. Debt is an addiction in its own right. And I'm not talking about debt where a company borrows funds to invest in plant and equipment or take advantage of, make an investment, which in an asset. I'm talking about borrowing on your credit card to get that new flat screen TV, to get that new car that your old car could probably go another 20, 30,000 miles. I've been guilty of it myself at times, but I've usually timed it right to get out of debt at the right time. But, you know, this time really is different, because this debt's got to get liquidated. You can't get paid on every level, governmental, individual, a lot of corporations, and something has to give. A basic systemic reform, going back to Glass-Steagall, because I don't think it's smart to have the salesman running the show. And going back to the concept of investment partnerships, where the partners have their own capital on the line and protecting the company, protecting the bank, protecting the brokerage was first and foremost, not extorting the bonus. And until we go back to that, what's going to happen? So the trend, I haven't seen it take hold yet, but maybe after the next go round here, it will.
Absolutely. You know, the John Corzine hearings, I think, are will be seen as something that was defining of this particular phase of this crisis, because, you know, the bankers are supposedly angry because people are hostile to them. And Mr. Diamond's always saying, people are so hostile. It's so unfair. It's like, you know what? How about we come take your seven houses? How would you like them apples? You know what? You guys hijacked the economy. You were the big men. You were paid the big bucks. You got counsel to all the governments and all the unsuspecting fools that we had in various government agencies and places. And you guys raped and pillaged. You took huge, ridiculous sums of money. And now that's all blown up and everyone's paying the price. But you think that you should be able to keep your embezzled funds out of the equation. And simply, that's not accountability. And so I think that we're going to go into a phase. If he thinks it's been hostile so far, I think he ought to see what's coming next, because I believe this won't end till we have things like, you know, prosecutions. Do you know, in other phases like this, there's laws brought in, for example, to ban pensions from buying equities altogether. That was in the early 50s, because the stocks had hurt people for so long, had decimated pension funding just like they have today. And the legislation was brought in to ban investing in that asset class. You know that we're at the end of a secular phase when you start seeing, you know, that level of repugnance in the population. And we're nowhere near that yet. Now, I don't think we've seen hostile yet. You know, the next downturn, I think, has started. The next cyclical decline has started. I think people may well revisit the 09 lows in this next phase. You know, I can't say if that'll be in 2012, but history certainly suggests to us that, for example, you know, when things got sold off in the 09 lows in March of 09, the reality is that was an enormous drop from where we had been in 07, like a 48% decline or greater. Mm-hmm. But in a historical perspective, it wasn't probably sufficient to overcorrect for the extreme valuations that we saw in the late 90s, because dividend yields never did get back down to anywhere close to 8%. You know, the PE multiples barely touched 10 at that time, and then rebounded quickly on the government intervention. I don't think we saw the permeable community wiped out to the extent that we will in the end of this particular secular run. I think that the business media, who have all become the, you know, call girls of the corporate community, I think the business media is in for a big downsizing. The financial sector is in the midst of its next major downsizing. And I think, again, by the time this secular bear ends, I think you'll find a lot less people in financial services, just like you've seen in the U.S. realty market with, you know, so many people working in the real estate side in the beginning of this decade. And now, you know, downsizing. Banks are back into laying off. You know, we saw the bank earnings disappointing of late, and they're laying off thousands of workers again. I think that we're going to see more of that to come. And that'll be good, because we had so many rats in the ship, and we really need to clean house, go back to those that have actual management skill, actual wisdom around money. They'll always be work for us, thank God. But we're, you know, the rest of the people that really weren't adding value will have to go find other places to work and to build a skill set, and that'll be healthy for the economy. But the other major factor, which is unfortunate, Carrie, because the boomers did such a bad management job, they did a bad mentor job to their children, but now they're coming into their high demand in terms of social benefits and medical care. So the Western world has really got the worst of all possible conditions today, because this period was coming. We knew it. We knew the dynamics of that, you know, 476 million people born worldwide in that what's called the baby boomer era. We knew that they would be getting to this age now. That was easy math. What they didn't do was plan or prepare mathematically for it in any way. So instead of building up the coffers to help fund the needs of the next 20 years, they depleted them entirely. And so I think now we're in a social dynamic in our world economy where the smaller pool of younger people, which are behind the boomers, have a direct conflict of interest now with the status quo, who is that, you know, boomers came into power when they were about 40, you started to see the presidents and the heads of all these institutions and banks. Well, those guys are all in their mid-50s now, moving through. Mm-hmm. And they want to maintain a structure which is no longer supportable. So you're going to have a lot more, you know, the Occupy movement was a lot of young people And people were saying, well, they're just lazy. They should go get jobs. No, it's actually not that simple. There aren't jobs for them for certain reasons. A lot of them would work, but they got out of college with massive loans because we made education a for-profit institution instead of investing to try and make education accessible. You know, so we've done everything backwards. And now I think we're going to have a period where everyone's going to have to give. We're probably going to have to pay more taxes in different ways. I mean, I say that as a high income earning person. I don't like tax, but I realize that there's only two ways to get out of the hole. You cut spending for sure, but you probably also have to increase revenue or have direct streams of money going to either pay down debt or fund social, social benefits or Medicare. I mean, obviously, you're going to have money coming in. And if you got less working people, you have to make that up somehow. And it's not pleasant, but it's part of the solution. And then it will too pass. You know, we will get to a point where we've built back up the equity and the cash in the system. And then we can look at, you know, taking back some of those rules, lowering rates, et cetera, but not yet.
Yeah, well, interesting point that you raised, because a lot of it's a demographic trend, because in the 80s, 90s, you know, population increasing, new household formations increasing. And now in the 2000s, those trends have reversed, which has definitely been like a throttle, further throttle down on housing prices. And the other thing is that these benefit programs, they're not sustainable. Yeah, we had our opportunity to fix them. Even Bush Jr. tried to I didn't like his plan, but at least it was an acknowledgement of a problem, acceptance, and that some action had to be taken. But we're kind of to the point where the debt really can't be paid off, and some of it will be inflated away, some of it will be defaulted away, and the rest we're going to be left paying for a lot of years. But every Western democracy is in exactly the same boat, and the problem is that they always counted on the boom to take care of the problems, and now there is no boom, and those problems have really come home to roost.
Yeah, and they also didn't do the right thing in the boom periods. Nobody wanted to pay for anything that needed to, you know, it was all about consume today and worry tomorrow. And that was my complaint, you know, about, there's a complaint I have about energy policy. We're using, you know, 120-year-old technology in automobiles, and every time we get into a downturn, people say, well, we can't afford to do anything more efficient now. Yeah, but you couldn't afford to do it in the upturn either, apparently, because nobody ever wants to do the right thing at the right time. And really, you know, these business cycles, in secular bear deleveraging phases, the business cycles are much more extreme. The recessions are more frequent, they're longer, they're more extreme. And so you never do really get back on your feet. Every time you start to sort of recover, you get the next down leg and the next layoffs and the next, you know, knock-on effects from that. So that's why by the end of them, people have really learned a lesson, because it's been an ongoing, you know, quick fix never teaches anybody anything, right? So when the stock market went for about 3 weeks there in 2009, it presented the best value we'd seen in 12 years. And we got a buying opportunity. That was great. But because of all the injections of stimulus worldwide, including China, everywhere, things got quickly reinflated. And then by 2010, you're back looking at not very attractive valuations, not good dividends, you know, high risk to capital. So quick fixes aren't the answer. And I think the thing that makes me a little more optimistic this time is that if we're in the next cyclical downturn here, if we get another global recession in the next 12 months, I don't think you're going to see the same emergency response. There just isn't the money, first of all. There isn't the appetite, I don't think. Now, I'm sure they'll try different kinds of QE, et cetera. But I think that sort of hope that everyone sort of blindly gave to governments and central bankers, I'm just not sure we're going to see that again. And that'll be a good thing, because the next reentry point for equities, for example, if we got, you know, 25% cheaper from here or so, you'd get some decent dividend yields again. And then if it takes the economy a few years to grind and slowly build back, I don't really care so much as long as I don't lose in the downturn and I'm able to pick up good income from some instruments without a lot of risk to my capital, you know, then we can sort of row our way through. It's not a sailing environment like a secular bull, but you can row your way through. And, you know, it's the people that'll be hardest hits are the ones that don't have any savings set aside now and can't find work. I mean, that's a disaster.
Sure.
Because, you know, you need to actually have some money coming in to feed your family.
Yeah. And I think you nailed it. Government dependency, really a major problem. So, Danielle, where do we find you on the internet?
Jugglingdynamite.com is my blog. I write on that pretty much every day.
All right. Excellent. Well, hey, it's been great having you on. Good perspective on the decline that we've been seeing since 2007. We'll check in with you periodically and see where it's all heading.
All right. Thanks a lot.